Hi, this is the Brexit Show, and today we're going to talk about the 10 ways that it could affect you if we have a no-deal Brexit. So number one, the contents of your shopping basket may actually change. So those things that you're used to buying, you may find that they are no longer available on the shelves. So what you find on the supermarket shelves could well be where you see the first effects. What we will find is almost 30% of our food currently comes from the EU. Now, it's likely that some foods, especially fresh fruit and vegetables, will become more scarce and more expensive in the event of a no deal. So how much do we actually receive? It's around 28% from Europe, as you can see. This is where we will see the largest problems. The food imported to the UK then by supermarkets is actually a massive 79% from the EU. Of that, 43% are drinks, 21% are fruit and vegetables, 14% are meat and fish, 7% cereal, and 16% other. So you're likely to see quite a considerable drop in these products. Where UK residents are choosing to travel next, you'll need to take extra measures with a no-deal Brexit when traveling to Europe. Millions of people from the UK are going to travel abroad each year, of course, but this could change if we have a no deal. Now, what we will find is that we've had a steady increase over the years, or the three highest years that we've seen is 2016, 17 and 18, with 53 million, 54.7 and 53.7 million. And it's important to note that the others are only 18 million to the rest of the world. We are going to see quite a big change. Now, if you are planning to travel, it is advisable that you make sure your passport is valid for at least 6 months. If not, then obviously you should check out the list of countries that you are traveling to in Europe that you will need to have this. Until recently, UK citizens who renewed their passport before it expired could have up to 9 months of the remaining validity added to their new travel document. But the government has now actually said that this time carried over may not count towards the 6 month requirement after a no-deal Brexit. So you will have to check with the government website for these exact facts and figures. And you'll also need to renew your passport before traveling if you don't have enough validity left. And that usually takes around 3 weeks to come back. But of course, if everybody is choosing to do this, there could be big delays. Visas. Now, you won't need a visa for stays up to 90 days out of any 180-day period in the EU or Iceland, Liechtenstein, Norway, and Switzerland. However, you may need a visa or permit to stay for longer or to work or to study. And again, you can get the advice of each of the country's travel advice from their government pages. Border control is likely to be stepped up, and the government has advised that the EU borders that you may need to show several extra documents following a no-deal Brexit. And that's a show a return or an onward ticket to show that you actually plan to go back to the UK. Show you have enough money for your stay, and use separate queuing lanes from the EU, the EEA and Swiss citizens. European health cover will also change. Now, if there's no deal, in theory, the cover provided by your European health insurance card, the EHIC, would actually cease to exist. So you may as well cut that up and forget about it. And you'll need to think about taking your own insurance and your own personal health cover with an insurance provider privately. Traveling. If you do intend to travel, you would really check before you leave for any delays or disruption because of a no-deal Brexit, especially if you have booked your flights or your holiday in advance after or following the 31st of October. Now, if you intend to drive in the EU, you will have to take care as well, and you'll need to take some extra documents with you, and a green card is one of these, which proves your insurance provides the minimum required cover, and you can get this from your vehicle insurance company. You'll need a GB sticker, an international driving permit for some countries, and you can check if you need one on the post office website. Now, the government says flights, ferries and cruises, the Eurostar and Eurotunnel and bus and coach services between the UK and the EU will continue to run as normal. But again, you should really check in advance to see if there will be any delays or disruption, as we don't really know the impact of a no-deal Brexit at this point. Bank cards. Now, if you have a bank card that's registered with a UK bank and you intend to use your bank card abroad to pay for goods and services whilst you're in the EU, as well as Iceland, Liechtenstein and Norway, the government has actually warned that it may become more expensive for you. And so you would be advised to check the full government travel advice website and how it might affect your holidays to Europe. So you may want to consider some other means, maybe using your credit card or maybe an international MasterCard to avoid these charges. Thirdly, you may need to check medication is available or it may be more expensive. So the ministers and NHS leaders have said that whilst every effort has been made to ensure there will be enough medicines available, in the event of delays from imports from the EU, we might encounter a delay in medication and obviously drugs that are required. Now, these include painkillers, antidepressants, common medicines, and the Royal Pharmaceutical Society has warned these common medicines might have a delay in supply. So that could be a little bit of a worry for us. And the drugs in short supply have been on the increase in the United Kingdom. And these numbers have come from the Pharmaceutical Services Negotiating Committee. So whilst we have regular fluctuations in medical supplies generally, there is a concern that a no-deal Brexit could actually make these shortages much worse. And the storage and stockages are in short supply. So you should really check if your supplies will be life-threatening, then you obviously need to make sure that you see your doctor before the 31st of October to make sure you have enough supplies. So other measures that have been taken to avoid this, however, are extra warehouse space for medicines, trying to secure additional roll-on, roll-off freight capacity in ports away from Dover and Folkestone, and building buffer stocks wherever necessary and possible, booking plane space for products requiring immediate shipment, and making changes to regulatory requirements, and finally strengthening processes to deal with shortages. Now, fourthly, the UK nationals living abroad may have to take extra measures. So I'm sorry, but those people who are in the EU currently as expats from the United Kingdom, there may be some shortfalls for you too. So the UK citizens living in the other 27 EU states, we have a total estimate of around 1.3 million. These figures were taken from 2017. So of course, these numbers are probably underestimated and it's likely to be much, much higher than this. The UK government has requested that EU countries reciprocate its promise to uphold the rights of EU citizens in the UK, meaning that the UK citizens living in the EU would be able to continue their lives as they are living them now. In event of a no deal, this would ensure that they have continued access to employment, to their healthcare, their education benefits and other services. And the government has announced the public information campaign and an increase in consular support for Britons living abroad, which has actually cost around £138 million. Again, if you're in doubt, go and visit the government page. Health in the EU, what can UK nationals expect from the health service abroad? So if you're visiting or you're working or living in the EU, you may find that your healthcare may change abroad. And so you will need to find out how your rights are affected as a UK citizen living abroad, and you may need to take out some extra insurance for this to ensure you get your medical cover. With regards to pensions, the UK government will continue to pay state pension, child benefits and disability benefits to eligible UK nationals in the EU. And of course, this is still very much needing extra details, so we don't really have that much information about this as of yet. We'll have to wait and see how this pans out. With regards to the taxes, the UK's exit from the EU will not change. It will have an existing double taxation arrangement which will apply to EU countries. Number 5. EU citizens may need to apply for settled status in the UK. Now, the government has reached an agreement with the EU as well as Norway, Iceland, Liechtenstein and Switzerland that will protect the rights of EU citizens and their family members living in the United Kingdom. Now, as you can see, we have a migration from the EU has actually fallen, and the total number of people in thousands who have actually migrated to the United Kingdom have actually dropped considerably. And this could be, of course, because of people who are fearing their status in Britain since the Brexit vote took place 6 years ago. Number six, importing goods from the EU may get more expensive. Of course, if we are importing goods from the EU without a deal, then we are more likely to pay higher tariffs. And so we're no longer in the common markets or customs union with the EU. So the free movement of goods and services that we were used to are no longer applying. So as a member of the EU, the UK firms currently don't have to pay any extra duties, taxes, or have customs checks on goods traveling to or from the EU. But of course, after a no-deal Brexit, new rules will apply. So UK businesses will need to apply the same processes to EU trade that apply when trading with the rest of the world, which is, of course, a real inconvenience for our UK businesses and for the European ones. 7. House prices could be affected. So these are quite considerable fluctuations, as you can see. So we've had a year-on-year percentage change, and we have the Nationwide and Halifax figures to help us establish how volatile the housing market has been. Now, what we will see is that actually there's quite a high uncertainty which has been created by the Brexit process, causing buyers and sellers to sit tight, causing a slowdown in the housing market. Annual house prices have grown, but it's actually seen a reduction for 6 months in a row, according to the data compiled by the Nationwide. And Samuel Toombs, the chief UK economist, he has said that Brexit's uncertainty was likely to have an instilled some caution in buyers. But of course, you can argue that people will always need somewhere to live, and so the housing market is likely to remain stable to some extent. But that's an arguable case, and we'll have to wait and see what happens. Number 8, mobile phone roaming charges may rise. Using your mobile currently in the EU is quite convenient. You can use your phone with roaming, and you can have your inclusive minutes according to your current tariff. But this is actually going to be more expensive for you in the event of a no-deal Brexit. Be aware that if you do use your phone abroad following the 31st of October, you may have to check with your network provider to see how much costs are likely to be. Number 9, some ports and motorways could see extra delays, especially these lorries coming from Calais to Dover and Dover to Calais, etc. We're likely to see a massive delay. Currently, only 3% of the goods are checked, and after a no-deal Brexit, 100% of the lorries will have to be monitored and checked. So it's going to cause quite a considerable delay for those lorry drivers. You should make this a priority that you check your delays and disruptions. Again, any travelling to and from the EU, whether it's via the Eurotunnel, etc., you will have to make plans in advance. Number 10, UK students studying in the EU and the EU students studying in the UK could face a period of uncertainty. Currently, we have more than 16,000 British students that have studied on placements organised by the Erasmus Study Abroad Scheme. This has been in place since the 1980s, and in 2016 to 2017, this is when we've had obviously the highest number of students. Now, UK universities have said that they would expect a similar number to be planning to do the same this coming academic year, but of course, as a result of the EU and the UK's discussions with a no-deal Brexit, we are likely to see a problem with this continuing. If the UK leaves the EU without a deal before the exchanges for the next academic year have been finalised, then the government would need European agreement to keep taking part, and this has issued a technical note explaining this. So it's true for both the UK students planning to go to EU countries and the EU nationals hoping to come back to the UK, there could be a problem for this continuing scheme, which is really unfortunate, of course, because it has been growing in popularity over the years, and it's allowing students to study abroad on both sides. You can find out more about this if you click on the link, what will happen to the Erasmus scheme after Brexit. Thank you for listening. I hope this has been helpful. Please subscribe, and I'll see you soon.